And it also occurs in mouse models. We know that ACE2 protein occurs in areas of fibrosis. Actually, in doing the literature searches, I came across a researcher in Germany who had published on this as a mouse model who worked in the same lab I did when I was at Emory. So that was kind of neat to see that. The other thing I didn't realize but came to understand is that the skin has a functioning renin angiotensin system. Remember, if you recall from your basic science, this is used for water and sodium regulation in the body, principally in the kidney. But this same system occurs in other organ systems in the body. The chief product of this system, the chief mediator of the system, is angiotensin II. It's a pro-inflammatory byproduct, which is normally regulated by that ACE2 receptor. And the ACE2 receptor can be soluble, and it can be cytosolic, it can be in the soft tissue, and it can be membrane-bound. So what blocks the ACE2? Well, angiotensin II converting enzymes actually block the production of angiotensin II. And this may be favorable if we assume that angiotensin II is a pro-inflammatory product. Could this be causing it? So ACE inhibitors are benign. They're easy to dose. They're rapidly, I think a third of the U.S. population uses them for hypertension. And they're rapid acting, depending on which one you're using. They have a slight hypovolemic effect, although it's not their, you know, so their principal mechanism of action. So could this work? Could ARDS, the angiotensin receptor blockers, potentially work? I don't know, but I'm thinking it's worth a try. Look back in the literature. There actually is precedence for using ACE inhibitors in dermatology. This is a colleague of mine in Charlotte who does hair transplant. And a patient came to him from India having had body hair transplanted into his scalp and got all these keloidal papules from the extraction of the hair on the chest through punch biopsies. And he had looked in literature years ago and said, let's try ACE inhibitors. And lo and behold, it actually improved these keloidal papules, which were resistant to intralesional steroids. And the only problem was once he stopped it, these came back a little bit. So he was hit one, but he's used them in subsequent for acne keloidosis nucae on the back of the neck, for managing that. So there actually is some evidence that this works. And if you look in the literature, keloids, hypertrophic scars, systemic sclerosis, and recessive dystrophic epidermolysis bullosa all have responded to ACE inhibitors. So there is a precedent for using it in our field. Oops, let's go back one. So I said, well, let's think about this pathway. So I came up with this crazy pathway that you can recognize the part on the left. That's the mRNA going in from the vaccine and generating that spike protein. What on the right was just my rendition of what's going on in the skin. So here we have in the skin, which could be lymphocytes, fibroblasts, adipocytes, all those things we talked about. And here we have this functioning renin angiotensin system going on in the dermis in the skin. What you have below is the filler. Now, we know we inject filler. We know it goes away. But again, it sits there for a long time. So what happens to it? Two things. Well, one, it gets walled off. So you get these lymphocytes around it. You can get macrophages around it. And they just sit there and they watch it. They're just sitting there watching it. It's a foreign body. The filler is also breaking down from long chain and short chain. Or some of the fillers have a combination of short chain, long chain to begin with. The short chain, as it turned out, I think it's the 30 kilodalton short chains, are more pro-inflammatory. So as these are being produced, you know, we think that this is what's causing some of these delayed reactions and fillers that you see anyway. And the Vicross fillers seem to be a big culprit for this. But what I thought was happening was this angiotensin II, which essentially is at a higher concentration because the brakes have come off of this process in the skin, is causing this inflammatory reaction to be set off. And here you can see the mediators there, TNF-alpha, interleukin-6, 9, and then some other inflammatory mediators. It also turns out that there are some CD molecules that increase mast cell activity and so forth that are also being released as part of this process. And so you're getting these quiescent fillers, and they're responding because the lymphocytes around them are responding and basically lighting them up. So I thought, this is what's going on. Let's try the ACE inhibitors to stop this. So I had, you know, so this is sort of the power of social crowdsourcing social media. I'm on a Facebook group with 4,500 dermatologists. You guys, Leon, you guys may know this group. It's really interesting. There's some politics in it, but what they really do is try to trade cases and we try to see what's going on. So I had two cases pop up on the group that were dermatologists that had these reactions that were happening in real time. This is one case here who had her lips and her cheeks develop some really solid, really firm induration immediately after, I think this is her second dose, 24 hours after her vaccine. And then this was another one that developed a reaction after her second dose, and she was an atopic and already on antihistamine. And then this was a third one, and this was a panfacial one. So this one actually contacted me, and I said, I've got a theory. Let's try the ACE inhibitor. Would you be willing to do that? I said, I would suggest lisinopril. It's got a short mechanism of action. It works fast. If you just do 5 or 10 milligrams, it's not going to kill your blood pressure. It turned out that her husband was a family practitioner, perfectly comfortable doing it. Joe and I were way over right now. I'm sorry about that. So I said, would you be willing to try it? And she's like, yeah, I'll think about it. I'll talk to my husband. She talked to her husband. Her husband said, fine, let's do it. So her reaction subsided within 24 hours. This one's reaction subsided within 24 hours. And then this one subsided within 24 hours. And you say, oh, that's nice. I mean, that's... So this one said, okay, I'm going to do my second dose of the vaccine. She was the first case. And I want to pretreat with this ACE inhibitor. What do you think? I said, I wholeheartedly agree with that. Let's do 10 milligrams. We'll start 48 hours prior to your second dose. So this is her after her first dose, 24 hours. This is her 24 hours after her second dose with the ACE inhibitors already on board. So she did not get the reaction. And, you know, second dose, you're supposed to get a worse reaction. She did not get a reaction hardly at all. So I knew I was on to something here. And since that time, we've disseminated this information and had, you know, dozens and dozens of cases have come up. Like this one was a dermatologist that we've tried this on that have worked. Does it work in everybody? No, but it's really interesting. Here's some treatment pearls. You can feel free to take a picture of this. I won't go over all of it, but it sort of says what I previously said about the dosage. There's a mention about previous drugs you have to be careful about, ones like spironolactone that change the serum potassium, because you can potentiate that. You have to be careful with that. People that are already hypotensive normally, you have to be a little careful about, because they could develop orthostasis. Angioedema is a very, very, very low, like 0.1% risk with people on angioedema developing these. And it's usually in ethnic skin, but you have to be wary of that. But highly unlikely to develop it within the first week of starting this dose. The cough with ACE inhibitors usually is chronic, takes chronic treatment to develop. So I didn't really worry about any of those. We started the medication, and I've had some really good success with it. As I mentioned, I would have never been able to test this without the crowdsourcing, because these events were so few and far between that there was really no way to know. I just happened to get lucky and get some of these events happening in real time. What we've determined for more crowdsourcing, and we're going to publish this, it's in, getting ready to be put in press, is Bicross. I think it's because of that short chain HA, but also because it's the most longevity of any filler in the U.S., and it's the most popular. But I've seen it with every single one of them, with the exception, a possible exception of Radiesse and Bellaterra, which is a very short-acting HA. And we've seen it with all the vaccines, including AstraZeneca in India and J&J. So it could happen with any one of them. Go back to just this case. It's very interesting, and I'll end here pretty quickly. This lady received the vaccine. She contacted me over the internet. Received the vaccine, got this reaction, was put on Valtrex by a dermatologist, still swollen, went to a plastic surgeon. He prescribed a Metrol dose pack, didn't do anything, went back to the plastic surgeon. He prescribed antibiotics, didn't do anything. He said, in the middle of the night, my lips were extremely swollen. I went to the ER. So she went to the ER, went back on prednisone and antihistamine, didn't do anything. Followed back up with her primary care, who sent her to an immunologist. The immunologist agreed with the prednisone, added more antihistamines, went to find some research. In the meantime, she was very, very swollen. She read it. We made these articles open access. She read the article, gave it to her internist. Her internist contacted me, 62 years old. She had this filler on board for 3 years, I think, prior. So we started the ACE inhibitor, and lo and behold, it went away. So it's an interesting report. This is another dermatologist that had some malar swelling 4 months after her vaccines, kind of an atypical presentation. She had had Voluma 2 years ago. We started the ACE inhibitor, and 1 week it was gone. This is a patient sent by a dermatologist in Morocco, just to show you that this doesn't always work. This was someone who was related to. You can see all the swelling. They did not have lisinopril. They tried one called periodontopril, which I'm not sure the pharmacokinetics of that. And he did not respond, so he was asking for advice. And We discussed antihistamines, prednisone, dissolving the filler. I never heard back from him, but I thought that was interesting. And then Sunil, I wonder if Sunil's in the room, but you know, I was presenting this at another virtual meeting, and Sunil said, hey, we tried this, and here's some of his patients. And you can see this one has some periorbital malar edema that responded really well to 3 days of 10 milligrams of lisinopril. You can see the improvement there. And then another one who didn't want to do anything and ended up resolving on his own. And he had, I think, radiesthesia and some HA. So these can go away on their own. So I'm going to stop there because you guys have been very generous to let me go over time. Happy to take any questions. And I can talk about, you know, what I would recommend going forward. But I just wanted to tell you the story. And you guys have only people to hear it from me live. So thank you for your attention very much. Take any questions or later? What do you think? Any questions, anybody? So people are recommending to wait at least two weeks after your vaccine dose to get the filler. If you've never had it, there's really not a lot of data to support that. But one thing I can tell you is you need to get a really good history from your patients because a lot of them forget they've had filler, and you'll be surprised. And try to get that history to let them know what they might expect going forward. So thank you, Joe.